Thank you for your interest in this presentation. Today, we're going to join Onur Tutuz of Memorial University as he talks about the advantages of using FTG system for detecting mineral potential. He's going to talk us through an example from the Budgell Harbour Stock in north central Newfoundland. Due to a technical blip at the beginning of his presentation during PDAC 2021, we're going to join the recording from his agenda slide. So, with that, I will get the presentation going. Thank you very much.
So here is the content for my presentation today. I'll begin by talking about what the FTG system is and then briefly explain the principles of gravity gradiometry method. Next, we will be looking at the data processing steps that done by the Belgeos space relevant to the case study where I will be talking about my thesis project. And finally, I'll be concluding my presentation by emphasizing the main points from my study. And I hope you find it interesting. So the full tensor gradiometry system is owned and operated by Belgeos space. The system consists of a three gravity gradiometry instrument, and each of which has four accelerometers. And this allows us to measure the full tensor of the gradient, which is the rate of the change of the gravity field components along within X, Y, Z directions. So it normally comprises of nine components. However, because the gravity gradient tensors are symmetric, and for the measurements that are made above the Earth's surfaces, gravitational potential obeys the Laplace equation, which means that the summation of the diagonal components of the gradients equal to zero. Therefore, we end up only having five components that are truly independent. For the measurements of the gradients, our units of the measurements is in yotves, which is equal to 0.1 milligal per kilometer. And on the right figure, you can see the schematic diagram for the gravity gradient tensors measurements. So here's an example of patterns for the ground gravity and gravity gradiometry data for a dense block that located beneath the flat surface and centrally. So the interpretation of the gravity gradiometry data might seem challenging. However, the useful thing to do is to start interpretation with the TZZ component, as this is the component that's most related to subsurface geology. And we can see that it directly delineates the dense block. And TXX and TYY indicate the west, east, and north, south edges of the block. TXY maps all other features that are oriented at the angle. And TXZ and TYZ show the central axis in the north, south, and east, west directions. So there are a number of advantages of using the gravity gradiometry data comparing the ground gravity. So it provides us a high resolution as we can measure the gravity both horizontally and vertically. Therefore, it increases the resolution. And also sometimes because of the hostile environment or accessibility, the data coverage can be hard with the ground gravity, but we can eliminate this problem using the full tensor gravity gradiometry system in airborne measurements. And also airborne measurements make the data acquisition rapid, more straightforward, potentially cheaper than the ground gravity. Another benefit of using the acquiring the FTG data is that we can also acquire the LIDAR and magnetic data simultaneously. So here we are looking at the experiment from Belgeos space for the depth resolution comparison of ground gravity and FTG data. This has answered by building a chart called geological detectability that plots increase in depth versus increase in detectability. So from this chart, we can see that the overlap between the FTG and gravity data occurs about at about 4 kilometers. However, this doesn't mean that the FDG will fail to resolve the geology greater than 4 kilometers. It just means that the conventional gravity will provide a more reliable signature at those depths. So acquired FDG data undergoes a series of processing steps to obtain final data for used for interpretation. So here are some processing steps done by BelgeoSpace for a airborne gravity gradiometry data that I will be talking about in a minute. So high rate post mission compensation includes correction for the gradient of the aircraft and the gradient of the instrument itself. And BelgeoSpace uses a 3D modeling package to calculate the terrain corrections. Specific line corrections calculates the tensor components from the measured inline and cross data sets, and then removes the low frequency errors through Bayesian line leveling. And final line leveling is applied to produce data suitable for mapping. So now we are gonna look at the case study from Budgess Harbor, Stark, North Central Newfoundland. The property is located in North Central Newfoundland, as you can see from the figure on the left. And the figure in the middle shows the geological map of the survey area. So reef type platinum group mineralization is presented area, as well as large scale deep gabbro intrusion, which is colored by red in this map. And also the lake sediment sampling by Newfoundland government reported high background copper, nickel, cobalt, chromium, gold, silver, and PGE anomalies. So the area is kind of interesting for an economic view. On the right figure, you can see that the topography map of the survey area that generated by using the Canadian Digital Elevation Model data. So an airborne gravity gradiometry survey was conducted by Celtic Mineral using the BelgeoSpace air full tensor gradiometry system in 2007. So line spacing was 200 meters and with the total coverage of 407 line kilometers. Planned flight altitude was 80 meters. However, due to the topography, it varied from approximately 70 to 265 meters. On the right figure, we can see the map of the flight lines for the FDG data. And these horizontal lines are called tie lines. The purpose of the collecting these lines is to make sure that data was collected correctly. So here are the maps of the six components from airborne gravity gradiometry data that are level, denoise, terrain corrected at a density of 2.7 gram per cubic centimeters. And if you recall our geological map of the survey area, we can see from the TZZ that it directly delineates the gabbro intrusion from the survey area. And there are a number of steps that are required before running the inversions. So we need to specify the data area which our interest will be taken part in. And then we need to determine the depth, width, and length of the desired mesh for the model. And then we need to generate tetrahedral meshes to reach the desired resolution of the recovered model. And finally, we need to avoid, in order to avoid the boundary effects where we actually have anomalies, we need to pad the mesh with additional cells. So our goal was to see this gabbro intrusion into our model. So the rectangular black box is here, showed our core of interest area. And then we start with integrating the topography and bathymetry information into the model, as you can see from figure A and figure B. By using the TEGEN, we generated 3D unstructured tetrahedral meshes. From figure B, you can see that in the middle of the figure, you can see the refined mesh area. This is actually where our core of, this is actually represent the, our core of interest area. We refine this area because it increases the accuracy. So we are now we are going to look at the immersion results of the gravity gradiometry data. We start the immersion with the TZZ component. As I mentioned earlier, this is the component that most related to subsurface geology. And from figure A, we can see the calculated data of the TZZ component. And as we recall our observed data, the shape of the observed data and the calculated data can be seen consistently, and figure B shows the normalized data residual map. This is essentially the differences between the observed and calculated data. And if we look at the scale here, zero represents the green color, which means that we had a pretty agreement in the between the observed and calculated data. And here we are looking at the recovered model of immersion result of TZZ component. Figure A and B show the cross section views of the recovered model. Figure C shows the threshold view of the recovered model. And for clarity, we removed the cells below 0.2 gram per cubic centimeter. And as it thought and expected to be, the deep, dense, centrally located anomaly structure correspond to the Bajil Harbour-Gabbro intrusion. So it is common to utilize all available information for the immersion, even though the TZZ component was sufficient to obtain the structure. So we inverted six component, the whole independent and TZZ component. So figure A and B shows again the cross-section views of the recovered model. Figure C shows the threshold view. For clarity, we remove the cells below 0.2 gram per cubic centimeter. And the thing is that providing additional components to the immersion, it kind of improved the structural quality of the recovered model for the immersion of six components. Another potential field geophysical method that usually used in a combination with gravity is called magnetics, which investigates the subsurface geology based on anomalies in Earth's magnetic field. So here is a survey from Geological Survey of Canada that was conducted in 1987, and figure A shows the flight lines for the this measure, this survey, and the line spacing was 1,000 meters, and it was kind of coarse. And figure B shows the total magnetic intensity map that was terrain corrected. Like we did for the gravity gradiometry data, we also did the same processing step before running the immersion of airborne total magnetic field data. So we generate the subset data from the observation points. And then in order to obtain the total magnetic anomaly map, we subtract the daily strength from the total magnetic intensity map. So the data that it goes to the immersion is total magnetic anomaly from the survey. So here are the immersion result of airborne total magnetic field anomaly data. And figure A shows the calculated data of the total magnetic field anomaly data. Figure B shows the normalized data residual over the COI area. So we can see from figure A that the calculated data and observed data, if you look at the scale of their scale, it has we did have a pretty consistency, and to prove that we can look at the normalized data residual, which is the differences between observed and calculated data. And if we look at the zero again, it represents the green color, and we had pretty consistency for the result of the emergence. And here are the recovered model of satellite recovered model result for the airborne total magnetic field data. Figure A and B show the cross-section views, and figure C shows the threshold view of susceptibility model. And for clarity, we removed the cells below 0.15 SI units. And overall, if we look at the emergent result of each data, we can see that the location and the depth of the intrusion had a consistency, but the susceptibility recovered model has a wider structure here. This is probably because of the line spacing that used for the survey. And to conclude my presentation, I would like to emphasize the main points. From this study, we have seen that the FDG data allowed us to see the key structures that are associated with the Bajil Harbour-Gabbro intrusion, and also 3D Earth modeling and immersion of airborne gravity gradiometry and aeromagnetic data help us to see the potential of the survey, potential of the geological structures in the survey areas. And from single component immersion results, we were able to delineate the structure of the Bajil Harbour-Gabbro intrusion. However, the additional components improved the overall structure of the density recovered model. And the susceptibility recovered model from the airborne total magnetic field immersion also indicate the depth of the Bajil Harbour-Gabbro intrusion approximately 5.5 kilometer, which was proposed before Miller in 1976. So I would like to finish my presentation by thanking the Professor Collins research group at Memorial University of Newfoundland. And I'm also, I would like to also acknowledge the Republic of Turkey, Ministry of National Education for their financial support. And of course, I am grateful to Belgium Space for giving me a chance to be here today, especially Julian Sharpless, who has been organizing these talks. And here are the references. And thank you for your time.
Thank you.